Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Institute for Government. I'm Bronwen Maddox, the director, and we're delighted to be hosting this this event, which we really, really care about. And I would say that about many of our events, but this one is special. It is based on this report, All Change, Why Britain is So Prone to Policy Reinvention and What Can Be Done About It, by Emma Norris and Robert Adam. And we've got a terrific panel here to discuss it. Nick McPherson, former Permanent Secretary of the Treasury, Rachel Wolf, former advisor to the Prime Minister, and Shi Onwuah is going to join us. She's running slightly late. But first, to kick us off, David Sainsbury, the chairman of the Institute, is going to say a few words about why this one really matters. David.
Ron, thank you very much. Normally, the chairman of the board of the Institute of Government does not appear on these occasions. But I thought on this occasion I would, because this is an area I'm very interested in and have had experience of both when I was in business through contacts with think tanks and also having had a period in government. And I just, before we get into the kind of more detail of the report, I just want to emphasize really two points which I think come out of this report. The first is that this reveals in these three areas a quite appalling situation because it's quite clear if you look at this, and indeed you know about these three areas of government, that we've had this appalling churn of policy, and actually the end result of it in I think all three areas is that currently we have very poor performance of government. If we just take the area of technical education, which I know most about, and most about the history of it, because I just recently chaired a panel on technical education for the government, the first report, which said we actually have not as good a technical education system as the Germans, was in 1870. Since then, we have had endless reports, endless churn of both policy and organization. And quite frankly, we are at today much the same position as we were then. We will be reckoned to be about 28th out of 33 OECD countries for technical education. Just to give you, I think, one startling fact on technical education, in 35 years, we've had 28 major acts of parliament on further and higher, further education and technical education. And that is in an area where there's not really any strong ideological differences. Everyone wants to do something for technical education, and yet we've failed miserably to do anything to raise the level of it. The second point I really want to make, which I think comes out of this, is actually the problem here is very largely we're very bad at policy making. Now this goes against all the myths of British government. One of the myths of British government I was brought up on was we're very, very good at policy. We're really excellent at policy. There is a bit of a problem on implementation, but on policy, we do this very well. I have to say from all my experience, and I think you can see it in this report, we're actually not very good. And one of the things we've got to do is actually make certain that in the future, policy making is actually better. Why is it that we're not very good at policy making? Well, first of all, I think you need to understand that what passes as policy making in government is often not policy making at all. A minister comes in, says, this is my policy, this is the manifesto commitment, and civil servants then have to produce a paper which says, well, if you this is your policy, this is what you should do, this is what bill you have to have, this is what way you have to implement it. That is not policy making, that is simply implementation, particularly through legislation. But the main thing is we do not have, I think, good policy making processes. First of all, we practically have no policy policy-making units. I think DFID is an exception here, but we don't have good policy-making processes. We don't have good policy units. And as a result, policy-making is done on a very ad hoc basis when the minister wants a policy to be produced. The first white paper I saw, policy document I saw produced in government was when I was in the what was then the Department of Trade and Industry, and the minister said he would like a white paper on industry in the knowledge economy. The way that this was produced was a senior civil servant who was actually in charge of regulation in the department was given the job. He wrote round a memo to other heads of department in the DTI and said, has anyone got any good ideas to go into this white paper? And then these were written up as documents. They were then at a meeting handed to the minister, who looked at them one by one and said, I think these look rather good. That was the policy-making process. At some point, someone said, well, of course, we need to have some statistics to go into this report. So in parallel with the policy-making process, some statistics about poor performance of British industry were produced. It wasn't quite sort of evidence, policy-based evidence. I.e., what often happened, I'm afraid to say, when I was in government, which is a policy was decided, and then people were asked to produce the evidence to back it up, but it certainly wasn't evidence-based policy. There was no sense that you look at the facts, you look at the evidence, and then you make the policy. It was also, there was no ongoing policy-making process by people who knew about policy-making. So there were no people looking on a consistent basis at areas of policy in the department to see whether research needed to be done, whether the policies were working or not, evaluating policy. All this took place on essentially an ad hoc basis. And there was no feeding in what I think you'll find in quite a lot of other countries. There was no constant process of getting analysis in from research units elsewhere, from academies and other bodies. To give you another example, I remember when we produced two energy white papers saying completely different things within 2 years while I was in the DTI. I remember on the first one meeting, and this is all anecdotal evidence, but I have to tell you there is so much of it, it pretty well comes as proper comprehensive evidence. I remember saying to him, well, how is the production of this white paper on energy going? And he said, well, it's going very well. We're just having a little bit of problem about getting the costs of different sources of energy brought together on a consistent basis. And I must say, at that point, I kind of despaired. I mean, the idea that you have an energy department dealing with those issues, which does not have a constant database of energy sources and a process for predicting what might happen in energy costs in the future, seems to me to be carrying the amateur spirit to extreme lengths. And the idea, which would seem absolutely obvious, which is you go to a place like Imperial College, which has good experts on energy, and just says, look, we want a contract with you. You will produce for us a constant updated information on what's happening on energy costs and indeed predictions about the future. And that is just a consistent input to our policy-making process, would seem to me absolutely obvious. So, in addition to the, I just want to stress before we get into the detail of this report, A, we should be very clear, this is a very, in terms of performance of government, this is a pretty poor performance. And secondly, yes, there's some good ideas in this document, but we really need also to tackle the fundamental issue, which is we're not doing policy making in a very professional way. Let me now hand you back to Bronwen.
David, thank you very much indeed. Thank you for that blast of passion and reminders about why this really matters. Well, let's plunge into the detail, and let's begin with Emma Norris, who put this report together with Robert Adam. And Emma, tell us about what this report has found in these three areas of industrial policy, further education, and the regions. Emma.
Thank you, Bronwen. So the central message of the report we're launching today is that change and reinvention, policy change, organisational change, personnel change, happens far too frequently in government and makes real progress much harder. New legislation replaces old legislation, organisations are quickly founded and then abolished, policies are launched and relaunched, programmes are created and abandoned, all at an alarming rate. And I want to take a few moments just to reflect on some of the numbers we found in the three sectors we looked at. In industry, we're on to our third industrial strategy in a decade, with accompanying institutional change each time. In regional and local government, churn has been so constant it's earned its own academic name, re-disorganisation. There have been 59 attempts to join up local public services between 1997 and 2015. In 1992, new unitary authorities were created. In 2009, unitary authorities were created again. Local authority leaders boards were created in 2009 to replace regional chambers, which themselves only lasted a decade, and then those leaders boards lasted only a year before they were in essence abolished too. The most severe change in turbulence was in vocational or technical education, and I think there the scale of reinvention of churn is really quite staggering. There have been 48 secretaries of state in the last 30 years, at least 28 major legislative changes. There are now 13,000 different qualifications that have been created. And no delivery organisation has lasted for longer than a decade before being abolished or reformed. The Quality Improvement Agency was created in 2006, then it was closed in 2008. Its assets and liabilities were transferred over to the Learning and Skills Improvement Service, which was itself wound down less than 5 years later. Now, we only looked at these three sectors, industrial policy, regional government and technical education, but I think the same pattern of churn would hold true for other areas too. Health immediately springs to mind. Now, the cost of change and reinvention is really significant. It costs £15 million to create a new department, for instance, just in the short term, and that doesn't take account of the temporary disruption to business, of people grappling with the logistics of creating a new department, and the potential loss of institutional memory. And the same considerations and the same costs apply to the frequent reorganisations that happen in the rest of the public sector. And then there's the wider social and economic cost of churn. In the further education sector, for instance, instability and reinvention have been so rife that students don't have much certainty about what value the qualifications they're gaining hold in the jobs market, or whether the qualification they've undertaken will even exist a couple of years down the line. Now, it's tempting to try and explain away this tendency towards reinvention as a byproduct of political change. As governments change, so does policy. But we found that the scale of the change is not just a result of ideological shifts. Now, there are specific reasons that some of the sectors we looked at are vulnerable to churn. Vocational education, technical education, for instance, suffers from being subject, I would argue, to a lower level of public scrutiny than other parts of the education system. Debates about its size, about its shape, and its objectives tend to happen outside the spotlight of media attention. You can contrast that with the kind of scrutiny that's applied to universities or the school system changes. I think that gives ministers and policymakers much greater freedom to make changes. In fact, the low profile of further education arguably creates an incentive to make changes. Ministers of state who are responsible for further education are competing for attention with other more visible briefs. In regional government, there are real incentives for change in that sector, not least because central government is nervous about devolving too much power when they think they will continue to be held to account, and the fact that citizens are unsure of what they want from regional government. They instinctively feel the existence of regional bodies that can engage businesses will be good for local economic prospects, but they also oppose more bureaucracy. But rather than focus too heavily on the specific sectoral reasons for churn, I want to look at what these three areas have in common. And I want to talk about four things that I think play into churn and start to briefly talk about what might be done about them. So the first of these is the observation that institutional memory in Whitehall is too weak. During our research, we saw so many examples of past initiatives being recycled, new organisations with similar remits to existing ones being recreated, or policies and organisations being abandoned before they've had time to thrive. Too often, there's a tendency to start from first principles without a sufficient grasp of what has already been done and why. Now, there are a number of solutions to this. All policymakers should be able to access a repository of work that has already been undertaken in their policy area to inform their own recommendations. We need a better understanding of policy history. And the senior civil servant responsible for policymaking in each department should be responsible for ensuring that knowledge management systems are in place, that policymakers are able to learn from history. The second point, which the Institute's talked about before, is that the incentives in Whitehall are often for change and turnover, to create new organisations, to be seen to be doing something. That's often a proxy for progress. So the first solution here is simply to start rewarding consistency. And I think the place to start is personnel change. In Whitehall, moving up often means moving on, but some of the most successful long-term policies have benefited from keeping officials in post over the longer term, allowing them to accumulate knowledge and networks. Government needs to look at how career incentives can be aligned with the need for stable and, in some cases, specialist teams. It's also far too easy in Whitehall to abolish old organisations and create new ones. So the Treasury, in conjunction with the National Audit Office, should analyse the costs and benefits of past organisational changes to help departments better assess proposals and provide challenge. The third point is that there's insufficient long-term planning in government. It's striking in our analysis, as I've said, that policy churn doesn't just happen when governments change, but within single governments. The problem isn't just with changing ideological preferences, but with a failure to really set out and monitor long-term strategy and plans. So there needs to be strengthened capacity for long-term strategic planning in the centre of government, in number 10 and in the Treasury. And then the fourth and final thing I want to mention is the policymaking process itself, as David has already mentioned. Policies need a clear and transparent evidence base. Policy announcements should be accompanied by the evidence base that underpins them, and departments should be required to acknowledge all the previous work that has been undertaken when developing policy proposals. That should be acknowledged in white and green papers. And crucially, policy proposals for change need to be more thoroughly scrutinised. And I think there's a strengthened role for Parliament there. Recommendations for churn or change in these three areas and beyond need to be subjected to much deeper checks and scrutiny. Okay, I'm going to leave it there.
Emma, thanks very much indeed. And again, a second challenge on top of David's to the quality of policy making in her suggestions about what might be done. Nick, I want to come to you next. We've had quite a direct challenge, one way or another, to how this is done at the moment. What is your take on it?
Well, I thought this is a high quality report, and I'm very glad the AFG is focusing on this issue. I mean, looking back, the two words which caused me most pain in ministerial statements or speeches were radical reform. And actually, if you look at most government announcements, they are always allegedly radical reforms, and that says something about how the British state operates. Why is that? Well, let's start. I want to focus on the civil service, but I think it does require a bit of political context. England, and I use the word England advisedly, is a very centralised state. Parliament devolves power with considerable reluctance. Unlike most continental forms of government, there is no proportional representation, which means that the need to build consensus is a relatively low priority, though I accept that the main political parties historically have been coalitions of sorts. Ministers get appointed, politics increasingly is a young person's game, and I know Ms. May, and it's a relief to have a Prime Minister and Chancellor again who are older than I am. Nevertheless, I don't expect that to last. Politics is a young person's game. You go through it, you get spat out relatively young. So when you get power, you are under huge pressure to do something with it. Otherwise, what was the point of devoting your career to that noble endeavour? added to which, once you're there, unless you're lucky and, you know, you're the Prime Minister or the Chancellor, chances are you're going to only be in your job for a couple of years before you're reshuffled somewhere else. So all of these factors, I should also say, how does, you know, if you're a lobby fodder, how is your output measured by turning up and voting on legislation? All of these factors encourage government by announcement rather than government by delivery. And it's very striking that with every new government, you have this year zero effect where everything the previous government has done is complete crap, and we are going to radically reform it, and this time it's going to be different. After about 2 years, the government of the day comes to its senses and realises actually this time it's not going to be different. And if you look at health reform, for example, and you go back to Ken Clark's reforms in the late 80s, every government has come back to a variant of Ken's reforms, but it's always taken them about 3 or 4 years and a very expensive reorganisation to do it. Anyway, that's politics. I'm not a politician. You know, if we can change it, great, but I'm not going to bet any money on that. And actually, you know, with our leaving the European Union and the United Kingdom showing signs of fracturing, you know, it wouldn't surprise me at all that actually this gets worse. The political pressure gets worse before it gets better. So taking that as the broader context, I think the issue is, what can the civil service do about it? And the answer is it can do quite a lot. I think it's terribly easy to be defeatist. I personally like the recommendations in your report. One of my obsessions during the decade I was in charge with the in charge of the Treasury was how unhistorical the civil service is. But the extraordinary thing about government actually is history does repeat itself over and over again. We have cycles. There is a need to deal with unemployment. You know, we all have an interest in driving up educational standards. And the Lord Sainsbury referred to, you know, reports about why can't we be more like the Germans in the 1880s. And my only worry is I suspect many a report has been written like yours about how we really need to ensure that people do their jobs for longer. We need to capture knowledge better. We need to evaluate policy. I can't actually point to specific reports, but I can remember, you know, there was a heroic phase post 1997 where briefly there was a government who really was interested in evidence-based policy and promoting better policy making, and there were lots of initiatives, lots of reports written. But the challenge is, how do you embed the changes you're proposing? And that is difficult. I mean, a lot of it is to do with incentives, and a lot of it is to do with leadership and consistent leadership. But at the heart of this problem is one which I think was probably identified probably by Northcote Trevelyan, but certainly by Haldane, and even more by Fulton in the 60s, which is, you know, do you want to have genuine expertise in government? Very occasionally in the Treasury, there would be somebody who probably because you know, they were thoroughly dysfunctional in every other respect, who was left in a particular position for a very long time. I mean, there's a risk in that. The Japanese civil service, I think, historically tended to have people who'd done their jobs for 10 years, and that can be an obstacle to progress. But just valuing expertise, incentivizing people to stay longer. To give an indication of my failure, you know, my mantra when I became permanent secretary was I wanted people to spend more time doing a job than learning a job, and I wanted to transform knowledge management in the Treasury. And I came up with lots of systems which are quite similar to yours, but did it change things massively? I think the Treasury has actually got interested in history. I don't know whether it'll last. But thanks to people like Peter Riddle, who's here turning up and talking about sort of interesting events like, you know, transitions and so on of from one government to the other, I think people did think more about those things. But the area I really struggled on was getting people staying post longer. And at the heart of that in the Treasury was a problem that just staff turnover was high. We were competing in a market. We weren't actually competing in the Whitehall market. We were competing in the professional service and city market. So it was difficult to hang on to people. But anyway, I've been talking far too long. But we shouldn't give up. The proposals in this are perfectly sensible. And it may just be down to my failure over the years that I'm not overwhelmed by optimism that this time it's going to be different.
Nick, thanks very much indeed. You brought us right up against the wall of embedded culture, if I can put it that way, and promotional systems, as you said at the moment. We'll come back to some of those points. Rachel, can I come to you next? Rachel's written one of the pieces included in this report based on the personal experience of what this looks like for the inside. Tell us.
So I'll start with one of the things I did say in that essay, which is over the last 13 to 15 years that I've been involved in policy in Westminster, I've been to, like most of you, hundreds upon hundreds of dinners, breakfasts, lunches, seminars, talking about specific policies. And almost invariably in those events, someone will say, well, of course the problem is that we keep changing things too much. And then the conversation will immediately move on to all the changes that the people in that room would actually like to happen right now. It is the plea, oh Lord, give me policy stability, but not yet. And I think we should all be honest that we suffer from this, as do I. I, for example, think that Lord Sainsbury's review on technical education is superb and we should transform it in the direction that he proposes, but let's not pretend it is not yet another transformation. And the other thing that I said, which Nick and others have already touched on, but I think is relevant, is that the sorts of areas that are focused on in this report have often been the preserve of junior ministers and sort of slightly under the first tier of attention. And that does make a difference for two reasons. The first is that I'm not going to say that they're the people who most deserve pity in the world, but it's quite tough being a junior minister in terms of demonstrating that you deserve promotion and that you're doing a good job. And one of the few ways that you have to do it is to do things and announce things and announce the sorts of things that will be interesting but not cause disaster to your government. And it is much easier to not cause disaster to your government in areas that people tend not to protest about very much. And technical education is a very good example. It is almost impossible to get the media really interested in technical education. So it is safer to change things in it.
You're making the point, is that actually, I mean, contrary to what you might think, actually these areas, even though they're not soaked in party ideology, they're actually particularly prone to change for that
actually,
reason.
Yeah, it's very interesting. Ideology in itself is quite interesting. I think the areas which are most ideological actually can be prone to less change. So I'll make a sort of distinction between two areas in education: school reform, of which I was very involved, and technical education, which is discussed in this report. I think you can very easily argue that there has been a completely linear process of school reform crossing governments over the last 15 years, which started with the early academies and moved on through what Andrew Donison and Michael Gove and then Nicky Morgan and Justin Greening are still doing. It's policy change, but I'm not sure I would argue it's policy churn. That is an area where people have had very strong ideological, if you like, opinions. It is based in a belief in autonomy or choice that has a lot of opponents to it. On the flip side, in technical education, pretty much every minister has talked about it in exactly the same terms, regardless of which party they were from. They all talk about employer engagement. They might mean slightly different things by it. It leads to different policies, but they all talk about the same things. It's not rooted in ideology in the same way, and I actually think that leads to more change, not less. The only other thing that I would echo that was very striking to me when I was in government, and I was not in government that long, and I was not a certainly not for being a lifelong civil servant, but that maybe made it more striking. Is this knowledge versus skills issue? So in the policy unit in number 10, as again most of you will know, often it gets the sort of very best and brightest young civil servants to work alongside the special advisors. And they are fantastic. They're all panicked at the idea that they might be there for more than 18 months because it means that their career is slowing down. Even though they're writing notes directly to the Prime Minister, it sounds like it's quite a good job, right? But they're panicked about it. And they're also often panicked about going back to the departments they came from. Having spent, you know, let's say 18 months in education, learning a lot about education, interacting at the very top levels, you'd think that would be a really good position to go back into the Department for Education. But this really worries them because they feel that it's not the route in which they're going to accelerate to the top. I mean, if you think about the education debates about knowledge versus skills, I mean, one of the things we now know is that you cannot be skilled without knowledge. It is not a perfectly transferable thing. It's not even a semi-transferable thing. And I do think that if we took the base of expertise and knowledge discipline more seriously in the civil service, it would make a very, very big difference. That said, I would be interested to hear more from Nick about why it is that everyone at the top agrees with this and it still doesn't change. I'm interested in what is stopping it. I do think it's an excellent report, and I would agree with the recommendations.
We'll come back to that, and thanks very much indeed. Thanks very much indeed for joining us. And look, we've got these two themes running. One, the degree to which this is an inevitable, perhaps, consequence of politics and a democratic system in which parties change and people come in, and the minister's desire to make an impact. And one to which this is a problem of the civil service, or at least one that the civil service could help counter by getting better at policy making, by using evidence, by not getting so panicked about promotion, this kind of thing. How do you see these aspects of it?
Well, let me start by giving a very politician's answer and say I think they're both true. I've just come from, sorry I'm late, I'm the Shadow Minister for Industrial Strategy, and it was business and industrial strategy questions in the House, so I've just come from there. During which, and to the point about government by announcement as opposed to government by action or even delivery, one of the ministers said of the NICS proposal that it had been mooted during the budget, as opposed to what we thought it had been, which was announced during the budget. And I think that is, so that's sort of illustrative of an absolute characteristic of government and of politics, which is, you could call it a flexibility, it's an uncertainty, it's a responsiveness. It is part of democracy as the worst system that has ever been mooted, apart from all the other ones that have been tried. And I should also say that I'm glad to hear that politics is a young person's game, having had a 20-year career in engineering before coming into the House. I'm far too old to be spat out as a young person still. Again, as a Shadow Minister for Industrial Strategy, the problem that I'm facing right now is not so much policy reinvention as policy continuation, but rebranding. So the government's industrial strategy is the government's productivity plan, just called by the term which is now more in favour with the government of the day, and very little has changed. And if you say what to me seems to stop delivery, it is ideology, it is execution, and it is investment. So policy churn, if you like, can happen because the policies haven't been delivered on, and they do need, but the policies were right, they have not been delivered on, they haven't had the execution capability or the investment to make them work. And in terms of, so obviously I'm focused on industrial strategy right now. We have had our consultation on industrial strategy, which closed a couple of weeks ago with 1,000 responses. What we proposed there to partially to address the challenge of effective delivery across silos and cultural change, which I'll just describe briefly. And it's not the answer. It's part of the answer. I would just say I'm a very strong believer in the fact that history does not repeat itself. Historians repeat themselves, and every challenge is a new challenge, and that does need to be recognised as well. I'm not saying that the civil service repeats itself, but there's a scepticism with regard for the potential for change stops change in itself. So in our industrial strategy, we are proposing what is called a challenge-led, mission-orientated and values-driven industrial strategy. And what that is designed specifically by looking to reflect and address the big challenges which we face to inspire change across departmental and private sector silos and sectors. So in order to affect change, change can't happen from one department on its own. And departments do find it, because of turf wars, because of personalities, for all the reasons set out in the report, very difficult to work together. So by setting out the great challenges, say, putting a man on the moon is the classic example, that enables assets to be mobilized across different parts of government. Now, that's a theory, and that's a theory put forward by the Economist, amongst others, Mariana Mazzucato, and there have been some successful examples of that. And then you need to add to that, you need a particular time measurable and time defined and specific mission that you can say when it has been delivered on. I think the other challenge with a lot of policies is you can't actually say when it's been delivered. You can't say when you've achieved it. When you've got all schools are good schools, well, your definition of good may change over time. Or an end to unemployment. Well, even that, given how you redefine employment and how you redefine benefits, that can be argued with. So you need to have something which is absolutely measurable and time defined, and which can be progress against which it can also be measured. And then the final part of it, which is values driven, is to reflect what the political differences are, because we do have ideological differences. I think one of the points that the report makes is that there's an industrial strategy specifically, there's an ongoing debate about the role of the state. That is a core ideological difference between the Conservative and the Labour parties. And it is right, in a way, that policy should reflect that. And we need to make make sure that our policies clearly reflect our values, so that our the electorate can recognise that, but also so that the civil service can recognise why. Well, values cut across any particular objective or policy decision, and understanding values enables, I worked in the private sector before coming into the public sector, but across both sectors, enables people throughout an organisation to have the autonomy to take decisions, because whilst the policy detail may not be fully accessible, the underlying values should be. So that's our approach, challenge-led, mission-orientated and values-driven. Now, in practice, when we get into government, we will see just how successful that is in overcoming some of the challenges. And the report's very useful. It is clearly a daily battle to affect the kind of cultural change, organisational learning, and mission-orientated approach that we need. We believe can deliver, for example, the sort of economy that we want to see. Yeah.
Thank you very much indeed for that. And there's a lot of important points in there, but I mean, crucially to me, that we can't shut out the politics in this entirely. In fact, we have to remember that that's what's driving it. As she put it, policies should change up to
of a point because of ideological or because of party differences, and that's why electorates voted for one party rather than the other. And I think it's important to capture that and acknowledge it. On the other hand, a lot of what we're talking about here as well is how to, while allowing for that, how to make policy, better in a way that it is more enduring. Emma, you've heard these three very different accounts and very, very different perspectives on this. We've got recommendations in this report which focus particularly on the policy making to try and get some continuity through all this. What do you feel we should pick out and emphasise from this?
So there are a couple of things I'd pick out. I want to first take up some of the points Nick was making about history and the use of history in Whitehall. And of course it is the case that this is a challenge that Whitehall has grappled with for some time. Nonetheless, I think finding ways to strengthen institutional memory is absolutely critical if we are going to break the cycle of churn, particularly, as Rachel says, when this is a moment, for instance, in technical education, where we have a chance to change the system and allow a reform to last. So the chances are that somebody's already thought about your big idea when you come up with it, but it can be difficult to find out what they thought, when, and how. So I think there's a real opportunity around, for instance, better record keeping, which sounds quite boring, but I think there are huge opportunities brought through digital to actually capture past work in a more meaningful way and allow that to inform future policy making. I think also the point on incentives is absolutely crucial. Yes, of course, it is difficult to maintain stability amongst the civil service, to keep people in post, to allow them to build the knowledge and networks they need to really have an impact on the policy area. However, there are opportunities to promote people in post, to create incentives for them to stay with an area. We've seen that happening in a few policy areas already. The Institute a couple of years ago did a big study of the Olympics and tried to understand why we'll be able to deliver this big major project so effectively when so often we find it very challenging. One of the things that stood out in that work was that there were real opportunities for people who were working on that project to be promoted in post. We saw it in other policies too, some of the more successful examples of pension reform, and also allow people to be promoted in post, so they allowed them to build up specialist knowledge while staying with a policy area or project. I think that is somewhere that we can make real progress. I also think there's something about what is rewarded, not just amongst the civil service, but amongst ministers. The sense that doing something is about ideas generation rather than delivery. And I think we need to think about how the system can reward delivery as much as it rewards ideas generation, and that is true both for the civil service and for ministers, I think. And then the final thing I want to emphasise is the importance of scrutiny and checks in the policy making process. And I mentioned that I thought the role of Parliament was critical here. Now, my colleague Jill Rutter, who's just sitting there, has argued many times before that a select committee should encourage departments to disclose the evidence base behind their policy decisions. And that's something I think could be a real help here. Exercises that require departments to disclose why they're doing something and why they think this change is necessary should be a routine part of committee requirements.
Okay, great. Well, we've got the evidence base, we've got the scrutiny and challenge of that, and we've got the incentives structure. And Nick, Rachel has thrown this challenge down at you. Come on, you've lived this for years, and you've arrived at this slightly world-weary tone about this.
It was time I moved on.
Frustrations? You are an optimist, and you've immersed yourself for years in this.
Yep.
Where did it get stuck?
It's worth. I'm just trying to sort of hang on to successful areas. I would say one of Britain's greatest successes in policy making and implementation over the last 25 years is the labour market. Britain's labour market in the mid-80s was a complete mess. It was performing worse than France's, definitely. And, this was a good example, picking up on Lord Sainsbury's point, of actually a wider sort of coalition of policy-making interests. Academia played an absolutely critical role, Richard Layard and Steve Nicol at the LSE, in promoting active labour market measures. Labour came to power in 1997, determined to pursue an evidence-based agenda to the extent that actually evaluation, a massive evaluation budget was built into the New Deal's funding. And actually the interesting thing is the incremental change, which was very ideologically contested from family credit, the working families tax credit, the new tax credits, to universal credit, all of which were building on the sort of technological frontier. The universal credit can use real-time information, which was just a dream back in the 1990s. And it may be very politically contested, but actually, if Labour get in, they can just put different numbers in the box, and you've got a really good system. So I think it's something about the government and the civil service being outward-looking, harnessing expertise outside government, building evaluation into the system, being open about the evidence base, and then really picking up on your point, incentivizing people to stick with the program. Universal credit went through a really rocky phase where it was getting, to use the sort of term of art, it was losing a senior responsible owner about once every other month. But actually, as far as I know, because I think I ran into him in an airport the other day, the SRO of Universal Credit has now been in place for 3 or 4 years. He's been incentivized. He's still there. And, one can complain about this and that in relation to Universal Credit, but actually the project remains on track. So there are things you can do. And I think actually it's also, look, the civil service leadership, this is about the culture of the organization. What people don't understand about implementing change there's a tendency not to understand, is actually change is, you don't just announce it and then the world changes. You actually have to relentlessly talk about it. It gets really boring. You get embarrassed repeating yourself, but you have to do it over and over and over again over a 5-year period. And on the back of that, you might actually have some impact. And yes, of course, the politics are moving you in different directions, and rightly so. It's not civil services' job to set the agenda, but it is a civil services' job to deliver. And it can be done, but it's hard work. It's repetitive, but you can succeed.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to go to question. Did you want to jump in on that?
I think cultural change is one of the most difficult and challenging parts in any organisation, but I do think the private sector is better at it than the public sector, and I think that's about the alignment of incentives and the willingness to change people as well as policies.
Okay, well, thank you for that. I can see there's a lot of questions bubbling up already, so let's go to questions now. I'll go in the middle here.
I suppose I should say I'm one of the guilty men, because I, in the Manpower Services Commission and the Department for Employment and the Department for Education, I was involved in technical and vocational education. To counter that, I was also involved in labour market policy, so that was the better side.
Yeah. Forgive me, would you like to give your name as well?
Sorry, and it's Roger Dorr. Yeah. And I think this is a good report, the report itself, I don't think, does bring out enough what we've been saying about ministers wanting change. I'm not going to be defending the indefensible, but most of the changes I was associated with were with new secretaries of state, often in new governments, wanting change quickly. And the easiest thing to change quickly are structures rather than policy development or delivery. And that was what one was faced with. Now, yes, our job was to give candid advice to ministers, oh no, not another change, that surely just stick with what we've got and try and make it work better. Not always easy to say that with a brand new incoming government wanting to see enthusiasm in their senior civil servants from the minute they start. So that is tricky, but so in some ways messages need to go down the political parties, as well as all these good recommendations, not to be constantly playing around with structure rather than getting on with policy delivery. I suppose it's a challenge to Chi in a way. I mean, can you imagine an opposition saying, vote for us, we're not going to change very much. We're not going to change structures. We'll deliver better, but no big changes. So it's a dual, it's all of this, plus rather different behaviour, I think, in the political world.
All right, well, thank you very much for that point. Let me take a couple of points, but we'll absolutely come back to that one. Let's come here on the aisle, and then David Sainsbury.
Yes, thank you. The most dreaded words I hear somebody in politics saying is the status quo is not an option, and we have a bold, radical policy for the 21st century, and it usually goes wrong, things like British Rail privatisation and the poll tax. I just wanted to ask whether we have particular problems in the UK, because the electoral system means that coalitions are out. For the UK experience 2010-2015 was, you know, very unusual for the UK. But the consensus seems to be that it actually worked pretty well. You know, people from different political backgrounds.
An interesting point. You say, are coalitions better at this?
Yes, and ministers in the continent seem to stay in place a much longer period. Yeah. I mean, Mr. Gromyko was Foreign Secretary for 28 years, something like that.
Well, that would be a different political system you're discussing. But thank you very much. An important point in there.
Do we need more coalition time?
Yeah, no, it's a really good point. Thank you. And let's just take a third one, David Sainsbury. But thank you. That's a good point.
Well, I would just like to put 2 points to Nick McPherson, because I think he made a very important point. This is partly about expertise and how you value it. Do you think it's a better way to proceed that you take someone who is extremely clever, has got a very good degree at Oxbridge, and tell them to produce a policy within 3 months? Or do you actually take someone who really knows about the subject area and has looked at it for a number of years? I think we were able to produce a very good report on technical education, because in fact, Nick Bowles, who was the minister, asked me if I could second to the department while we were producing the report, the guy who works in my charitable trust on technical education and has done so for 10 years and knows an enormous amount about it, knows what other countries have done, and was able to bring that expertise to the situation. So I think we do need to think about whether the people and the knowledge they have on policy making on the subject area is the right one, because you can be very clever in my experience, and it will take you 2 or 3 years to really understand a particular area of policy. Now, you may say you don't need to have that. I think you need to know really about the policy area. The point I'd like to take him up on was, he said, well, it's very difficult to do this because we have high turnover of people in the civil service and the treasury. Now, there is an issue, which is quite fair, which is where the salaries of people in government are out of line with the private sector. But actually, the turnover in the civil service, which is appalling, has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with the personnel policies of the civil service, and it is really essential that that gets reformed. What it involves is first of all, of course, it's encouraged. While I was in government, or I think it was just before, the cabinet secretary wrote round and said no one should stay in post for more than 4 years because they would get stale. They'd also, of course, know something about the subject area, but That was the encouragement. Don't stay in the job for more than 4 years, which means after 3 years, people are already looking for the next job. Secondly, you have far too narrow salary bands, so the only way you can get a higher salary is to move to a new job. And then, of course, you have the previous cabinet secretary comes in and says there will be no salary increases unless you move the job. And the result of that was, of course, that everyone spent all their time trying to go to a new job. Mm. So I just want to say, it's not something that's visited on the civil service, it's something that the civil service actually allows, if not encourages.
That last sting in the tail, the key point. Look, we've got three really great points there. I'm going to come to she and Rachel first on the political ones. First, ministers want change. They just do. That's what ministers are. And then the second point about whether coalitions are actually rather better at this.
Which
Rachel, wouldn't you start, and then I'll come back to you. And then I'll come to Nick on this.
So I'm going to speak somewhat in defence of politicians. And first of all, I do think that there is a difference between policy change and policy churn, right? If we all went back 100 years and morphed every single thing that the government was doing then to our current government and didn't do all the things that we've done since, we'd all be pretty horrified, right? Like, there is an argument for policy change. And you could argue that the sort of two most radical shifts in the 20th century, the creation of the welfare state and then the Thatcher reforms, both of which happened because a new government came in, were pretty central. I would also say, my personal experience, that the ability to develop policy in opposition, when you are seeing A, sort of the problems from afar, B, you actually are talking to far more external people and experts because you don't have the civil service to rely on, and you have time to think, has, in my view, led to more sensible policies than many of the things that were tried to be done while also running government. And again, I'll give the example, whether or not you agree with them, the sort of coherence of the school reforms by someone who was shadow Secretary of State for many years, stayed Secretary of State for many years, and I think somewhat thing that both the coalition and Conservative government did is they kept people in post, is important. So you do want policy change. Should I come on to expertise, or do you want me to stop there?
No, for I'm going to throw that one at Nick. Just on the politics of this, how much of this is inevitable? As Rachel's saying, I mean, we want policy change to some extent. What we don't want is churn of people throwing themselves repeatedly at the same problem, almost because it hasn't been.
Okay. Well, let me make two points quite strongly on that. I mean, I think the point about politicians coming in and wanting to change structures, and the particular challenge you put to me, I mean, we have said very clearly that whilst we do not, as we think that, for example, the change of RDAs into LEPs was a mistake, we will not do an organisational change there. We've said, you know, that whilst the last thing the health service needs is, whilst it would benefit from structural change, the last thing it needs is another top-down reorganisation. So I actually think that in a number of particular specific areas, we have been quite clear that we will keep the structures that we have, and that I mean, I think you make a good point, though I'm not entirely sure about the way in which you make it, because politicians do come in wanting change. And just let me say also, there's a sort of tone about change in this room, which, you know, for those who have, for whom the status quo is not acceptable, for those who have been left behind, for those who have nothing to lose and who voted because they had nothing to lose, change, it's not that, oh, we'd like some change, but not if it upsets our departmental structures too much. Change has to happen, and politicians need to make that absolutely clear, that the vast majority of people in this country need things to change for the better. So I think, you know, I think we have to be very careful about the tone that we used when discussing these very real structural and organisational and cultural challenges.
I think, again, I think that's really important. And we're getting a clear distinction between change and this churn of policy. Nick, and I can come to Emma. Do you want to come on?
I just want to comment in on the point around the role of ministers, because I think it's the right challenge. Clearly, this is not something which is the remit just of the civil service. And so there are a couple of things that I think the political system could do that would make policy stability easier. Now, Rachel's already highlighted opposition policymaking. I think the perspective of the Institute and some of the research we've done on opposition policymaking is that it's far more mixed, actually. There are some examples of very high-quality opposition policymaking, and there are some examples of very poor opposition policymaking. And poor opposition policymaking can lead to a tendency to change things without a proper understanding of why they stand as they do. A good example of opposition policymaking was the creation of the minimum wage, where huge resources were invested into building external coalitions to make that policy stick when it was in government. And so doing opposition policymaking well and investing proper resources, I think, is one route to greater stability. I think the other is, of course, we can't... coalition government is not the norm, but I think there is an opportunity for parties of government and oppositions to engage more on issues which are not areas of huge ideological difference. Again, throughout our research, we've seen examples of where sitting ministers have brought in their shadows and talked them through why particular changes are being made and brought them on board, which has then led to less churn in government. So I think there are some opportunities for ministers there too.
Thanks. Oh, thanks. Okay, well, that was the ministerial envelope. Let's come to these points that David Sainsbury has thrown down, Nick, which I think to you. It's quite a direct challenge to the civil service organisation of this.
As ever, they're very good points. Look, first point, I personally believe there should be more interchange between the public and private sectors. Occasionally the PAC criticises that for sort of revolving doors, etc. But just to use two examples, while I was at the Treasury, we brought in Edward Troop, who's a very successful tax lawyer, to work on tax. He's now chairman of HMRC. And you know, he had hugely deep expertise, which undoubtedly added to the quality of tax policy making. Ditto Charles Roxburgh, who'd been a partner at McKinsey's for 20 years, specialising in banking. He came in to the Treasury to run the financial service side. His experience, the depth of his understanding of the sector was hugely valuable. I think we can do more of that, and we should. Other challenge, I remember that particular here today, gone tomorrow, Cabinet Secretary's policy of making people not stay for 4 years in a place. I mean, look, they never did stay 4 years in a place. I don't understand quite what that was all about. And I can remember also some Cabinet Secretary having some mantra about, you know, you had to get on, you had to move out or something, but it just encouraged everybody just to move the whole time. So, look, we discussed things you can do about promoting people in post, redesigning posts so that people can stay there. I think, I mean, look, the Treasury, as ever, must take its fair share of the blame. There's always a tension if you're in the Treasury because pay reform is very dangerous. There's a whole history of pay reforms which, once announced, the Treasury has lost control of the pay bill. I can remember the famous Alan Milburn announcement on Agenda for Change, which was supposed to have been agreed with the Treasury, but so bad was the relationship between Mr. Brown and Mr. Blair that Mr. Milburn was allowed to announce it without clearing it with the Treasury. And you know, the Clegg reforms and so on. So you want to be careful. One of my regrets, I think, and John Kingman challenged me a lot on this in my final years in post, was that the Treasury needed to stop being so hair shirt and get a grip on this issue. I think, you know, look, clearly there are more things you can do. You can, as you say, you can exploit quite broad pay bans. The problem, if you're sitting in the Treasury, is always that the incentive then to departments is always just to use what is supposed to be a targeted system to reward everybody, because that's the easy option.
You can do what business does, which is you just give a budget for the amount of salary increases and leave it up to the departments as how they use those.
You can. But there is a tendency then to do it in a way which produces spending pressures beyond the time period in question. Anyway, look, Julian Kelly,
finance director for government is sitting two rows behind you, and he's uniquely placed to make a statement on the Treasury's policy on pay.
I notice that they're rather tempting. You're sitting there, Julian. Julian, would you like to say anything?
I think you should.
No, not a formal statement. Would you like to just chip into this debate? Because you know, this is a challenge that David and others, and indeed our report, have thrown down to the way the civil service organises and incentivises its people.
I completely recognise all of these challenges. And so, if you see what we're doing at the moment, which is even looking at specialities where we definitely have problems with recruitment and retention and have explored quite a lot more pay flexibilities. We're currently piloting pay bill control. So the sort of idea that David Sainsbury has raised with some departments now to test out, if given the flexibility, how do departments use it? Does it lead to a better result? We're evaluating that at the moment. So I think we are pushing the boundaries a bit, but recognising still the sort of fiscal constraint we're operating with.
Can I make one very small point on this? The other issue which civil service management should take 100% responsibility for, since it's their idea, is, you know, during my working life, we moved from total career planning. You were summoned up to the HR department and told you were going to X next and had no choice in the matter, to the 180 degrees opposite, which was a fully free jobs market where you could apply for whatever you wanted. And the reality is there is actually a perfectly, and the private sector does this very well, a perfectly sensible place in between those two extremes, which is about managing people's careers. So, you know, one of my frustrations at the current time, and it's always easy to be frustrated when you're not responsible, and you can argue I should have done something about it when I was, is the lack of expertise in government on trade and Europe. This is actually something which is quite easy to manage. You don't stay in the same job, but you stay in the same discipline, and you carefully help people to plan their careers so that they become really very deep experts. And I can think of a lot of very successful careers which have been built on that basis. And so I think civil service leadership and management really needs to put a lot more effort into career planning, a lot more effort into succession planning. That doesn't mean that you're interfering with free and fair open competition. It's just giving you a better chance that when jobs come up, you've got some decent people to choose from.
Okay, thanks. Yeah,
Yes, go on. A quick point, having worked in the private sector for all over the world, then moved to Ofcom, which I'm not sure, it's not officially civil service, but it is a public service, I would say that the quality of management, and I'm sure that I experienced in the private sector, was generally much better, much, much better than in the public sector. And I think the point that Lord Sainsbury's makes about valuing expertise is associated also more in the private sector, because there is greater measurement against success, against projected success. So whether you get your results in or whether you build the number of products you've promised, whereas something that amazed me in Ofcom was how much we could put forward great policies and nobody ever measured whether or not they'd succeeded.
Let me take, there's a lot of hands up still. Let me take by the fireplace, right in the front. Robert, did you want a question? It's not often people hand back the... Fine. That's fine. Then straight in front of you. Let's take those three.
Thank you. Caroline Robertson, City and Guilds. I was previously Assistant Director of the UK Commission for Employment and Skills, which ended up on the bonfire at the end of last year. So I'm fully aware of what churn means to me personally. But I wanted to make two points, and that's on the back of Lord Sainsbury and Lord McPherson about the bringing expertise in. I think we should go even further than that. My area, which is further and technical vocational education, the policy makers, the civil servants, are not products of that system themselves. They are generally academics. They've been through the university system. What we need to encourage is more and more people coming through the technical route, either the work-based route or the institutional route, to go into the civil service. And how many ministers are actually products of the industry routes through education? Not many of them. So I think we've got a fundamental challenge there. The second one was about structures, and this is about stability in structures. And I think we are very pleased to see the Institute for Apprenticeships being set up, but how arm's length and how independent of government will it be? Because I think we have some very successful models overseas. You've got an organisation called BIB in Germany, which has a similar role, which has been around for many, many years. And I think it's about, if you do set up structures, stepping back and allowing them to get on and do the job, so effectively depoliticising it and allowing them to do their jobs.
Thank you very much indeed. Here in the front. I'm going to try and come to everyone. We've got a bit of time.
Aaron Yamwa, HM Treasury. Sorry, Nick. I really like the question about how do we persuade governments to stop reinventing the same policies? But is it the case that this happens because the problem still exists? So Lord Sainsbury's example about technical education, that problem is exactly the same. And if that is the case, can an alternative question be actually, how do you persuade government to invent new policies, both on the civil service side, but then actually how do you get ministers to genuinely, go with something new rather than, shuffling their deck chairs around, calling it new, and kind of punting it out?
Very good point, thanks. And let's take a third point right here in second row.
Thank you. Peter Kane, City of London, ex-Treasury. Two quick points. The first is around, we can all agree in this room about the importance of value of evidence-based policy making, but actually out there in the public there's probably never been greater cynicism about evidence and facts in a Brexit Trump world. So how do we reconcile those two to bring together kind of a wider public recognition of the value of an evidence-based approach? My second point is that, again, we can all agree that scrutiny, evaluation, really important, but it takes time, and yet at a time when change out there is happening at an ever faster pace with technological opportunities. So is there a trade-off here about risking we'll be behind the curve of change that's happening if we're too slow in responding to those changes? So is it more about how we adapt to change and can be more agile, as well as making sure we properly scrutinise policies before they're implemented?
Okay, great. Thank you. I was going to say three very good points, but in fact, six in the modern fashion. Rachel, do you want to?
Before I do, one thing I should say is I'm slightly worried by how much is coming from the Treasury, because certainly in my experience, the Treasury is just weird in every single way compared to the rest of the government. So I'm not sure that its experience is totally typical in terms of how the rest of government functions, but I'm sure Nick will agree.
Weirdly nice and affectionate.
Weirdly brilliant and lovely to work with, but different. So, on public engagement with facts and evidence-based policy making, I'm in the middle of a family civil war on Brexit, but it would help if the forecast came true. The truth is that in many areas, the degree of precision of evidence is not as great as we would like or we pretend. Evidence-based policy making is a very easy thing to talk about. It's a lot harder to do, and often there are inherent trade-offs between two different sets of evidence, and it's not obvious beyond a political judgment and what the public wish where you would go. So I think it is a little easier to talk about evidence-based policy making than to do it. And I sort of think that links to your question, right? Like, policy making is hard. We shouldn't forget that one of the reasons that we come up against these problems is because it's really hard to do the right thing in the sorts of challenges that you have in modern governments. And there are actually relatively few people who I think are very good at doing it. And the reason that we make mistakes is partly strategic planning, partly because actually the evidence base is usually much weaker than you would like it to be. but partly because there are trade-offs, and partly because you just don't know. Like, we don't know how to run countries perfectly. We don't. One thing that I would like to say, just because expertise keeps coming up, is from my experience when I was in government, I thought that the relationship between government and academia was very imperfect, but it was as much on the academia side as it was on the government side. And I mean two things by that. The first is, and I'm the child of an academic, so I'll probably be forbidden from entering into the house after this. But most academics are actually very bad at figuring out how to get their ideas in a coherent and accessible form to government. And actually, I would say the academic incentives directly push them against doing so. And I think that's a real problem. I also say that when I was trying to do policy in government, I would very frequently call up the centres in Oxford or wherever it was, who were supposedly working on these issues to help me. And the help I got was pretty mixed, right? They're, you know, it ranged from people who were very willing to engage to people who wished to immediately charge Number 10 to get them to do some work for them, to people who would come along to seminars where you talk about things like industrial policy and say things like, well, it'd be really good if you could reflect skills next time, which is not a super helpful and detailed point. So there are phenomenal academics out there who have, I think, directed government policy. I would not say that there is a massive pool of people coming up with detailed, implementable ideas that you could immediately take. There aren't, and I wish we could change that.
Thanks.
Hi, thanks. I'm afraid I've got to be back in the house for 2 o'clock, so I'm going to have to just make these 2 points and leave, which is fantastic, and then you can judge the success of my points at another point. So just on academics, what I find as somebody trying to make policy in opposition is that academics tend to take what it was they'd researched and decided about 2, 3, 4 years ago, put another sort of intro on it, and then tell you that it is the proposal which is going to resolve whatever it is you're trying to address. And I'm afraid that is often, you know, it's simply too obvious. So I do think academics, you know, need to it's difficult in the academic career, but need to invest time in understanding what the specific challenges are that we are looking at, and indeed the values also which drive the responses that we're looking for. And in terms of the evidence base, and I do think that even Michael Grove claims to be, if not regretting, then having been misunderstood when he made the comments about experts. But I think we need to absolutely focus on evidence and the evidence base. I think moving to a post-evidence, post-fact politics would not do us any good with the people we claim to represent or to be acting for. But I do think evidence based, as you said, has a wide range of meanings. And I remember, and it's not always rigorous. And I remember, and it can be very economic based. So I remember, for example, when I was in Ofcom, looking at the problems associated with nuisance calls, and the evidence for the cost of changing all the operators' software was very clear. The evidence for the benefits was much less tangible, and so every time it came up, it was, well, we can't change this because we can measure the costs but not the benefits. But if you talk about people and real people and what their experience is, you need to have an evidence base which bridges that gap in a rigorous fashion. I dislike those reports which just seem to be economists measuring things based on guesses, if you like, but we do need to, I think we need to invest more in measuring benefit, in rigorous measurements of benefits that mean things to people, and having a narrative to put that across. And I think what would help with that is having more experts in and more value for experts. It's also having more people from different and diverse backgrounds and communities in the civil service, which can still look not at all like the Britain that we are trying to improve.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you. We're coming, there's a forest of hands now. We're coming towards the end. Let me try and squeeze in a few more points. I'm spoiled for choice. Right at the back, you've been very patient. Yep. There, here, And I'm really sorry, I'm going to have to apologise. And there, yeah, let's take those three quickly.
Yeah, Andrew Stanley, Institution of Civil Engineers, and 40 years of institutional memory working in vocational education. I'm going to go back to work and I'll be standing in various employer forums talking about the sort of hook that got me here, Sainsbury reforms, the 15 routes. And these employers will have been burned by the 14 to 19 diplomas and the engagement they put in there. They're going to look me in the eye as a trusted person and say, okay, Andy, do we engage with these? So what answer do I give them?
Thank you. Sorry, did you want to come back on that?
No, fine.
The next one was right here and towards the front. I'm sorry, and then I will come to the chap on the aisle. I'm sorry, so people are discovering their questions as the debate goes on.
Hi, Chelsea Day said, so I work in professional services, but I actually took a secondment into government, so I have kind of both perspectives. And it was more of an observation. I think, first of all, I pick up on the point that we kind of make this sweeping statement that all of government is the same, and actually my experience was this idea of kind of evidence-based policymaking really does vary across departments.
Yes.
And I'd also say that in my observation was there's probably a fine balance to strike in terms of having an evidence-based policy, but actually your ability and skill in pitching and selling that to a minister. So I was at the Treasury, so my experience there was how good people were at that that kind of pitching and playing to a political agenda, but perhaps didn't have the time, capacity, etc., to actually substantiate all of that and reliant on other departments. And I think the flip side of that is that some of those other departments that have actually real expertise, deep expertise, but can't actually necessarily influence in a way that would really get that policy off the ground and make it attractive to ministers.
It's a really important point. Thank you very much indeed. We take the Lejean, the chap on the aisle right by you, back there, who's been very patient. Thank you.
Sorry about that. I just want to make a comment on evidence. I haven't
read
the
report. Would
you
like to give
your name? Sorry, my name is Oaken, and I'm going to speak. I've got broad background. I've worked for the LSE, the Bank of England, and currently work for the Energy Regulator. I spent 6 years in finance. So my comment is there's something called the herding behavior, where if you do something different from what others have been doing, you own that responsibility, you're held accountable to that. So rather than the degree of churn or policy that's put out there, I think probably a better focus would have been on accountability, having people on the policy they develop and carry that with them, the success of that policy as is done in the private sector. I think that's much more, a stronger, tool to use. So people can be punished, because when we elect new people or change government, we are asking for change, and you give people the opportunity to run with that and then hold them accountable to that. So link people to the new policies to bring and let them carry that all through their career. Evidence-based policy, now working for the energy regulator, there is a problem there, because the people who generate the evidence and those who select it and those who have to make decisions on the evidence are completely different sets of people. And there's a lot of room for things to go wrong. And to finish up my point, the policies that have survived long enough are the ones that you could arguably say have been quite successful. There are a number of policies that have not seen the light of day or have not continued on. And there is a cost to a policy. Well, I would say to deliver on a policy that's well executed, whether it's a fantastic policy or not, is not quite difficult. But there is a cost to getting marginal benefit from a policy that's been running for a long time compared to the cost of continuing with that policy. As I've seen currently in the energy sector, people are bound to continue a political policy because they're used to it at tremendous cost to consumers. That's not really picked up, but it is delivering marginal benefit. So There are lots of trade-offs to be made.
Thank you very much indeed. And your point about accountability is an absolutely central one for the Institute, and actually interesting suggestion. We're coming right up to the end, and I'm so sorry. I really do apologise to the couple of you who've had hands up. Nick and then Emma for your last thoughts on this.
Well, last thoughts. I think we do need to get better, but we can get better. It's always very easy to focus on all the areas where things go wrong. You know, at any during any period, there actually are quite a lot of policies which are embedded, and you will be able to say that this time is different. And the critical thing is to stick at it. You know, I can things like. I mean, a good example of where policy's got a huge amount better is where people have used pilot schemes and random assignments in terms of the particular treatments policies have, and then have actually done some analysis on what happened. So I remain an optimist. Accountability does lie at the heart of this. I think the challenges you are throwing down to the civil service are the right ones. And let us hope that the civil service leadership, which is now in place, is going to deliver.
Okay. Emma.
I'm glad that somebody asked about T-levels. I thought this would come up. So I think the argument that I would make about the T-levels reform is that this is really a reform that is acknowledging the consequences of churn, which is the proliferation of up to 13,000 different qualifications in the further education sector. And the simplification down to 15 routes is actually an attempt to deal with some of the consequences of the churn and change we've seen in that sector. I think the danger is this reform is revisited in another 5 years and changed. What we actually need is to see a real political commitment to seeing it through this time, and it looks like we might get that. I think the point about accountability is absolutely right. Accountability is clearly absolutely key to trying to limit churn and see policies through in the long term. In the report, one of the recommendations we make is that it needs to be clear who in departments is responsible for institutional memory and making sure that Whitehall is able to understand where policies have come from. So I think that that is completely right. I share Nick's optimism that this time is going to be different, and hopefully our report recommendations will be listened to.
Well, look, Emma, thank you for that. Thank you, everyone, for coming. I'm really sorry for those who I couldn't get in. We're not going to give up on this. This is simply one report of quite a lot of events and discussions we're going to have on this theme, because it's one we really care about. Not least, we are going to work with the Centre for Science, Technology and Innovation at Cambridge University in promoting the evidence-based basis of policy making, one of the themes of this discussion. But we've had a lot of important themes here. I mean, we've had the, you know, very important political voice saying, look, change is essential, in a sense. Change is what many people in the country want. Change is what we all want in the end. But that is quite different from the frustration that we're talking about of hurling ourselves repeatedly at some areas of policy. And we've identified, you know, four or five different areas in which policy making could be considerably better. So thank you for coming. Not the last you're going to hear from us on this at all. Please join me in thanking our panelists and David Sainsbury.